Hello and welcome to another game review. Today we're looking at Astray, a 2D action puzzle platformer developed by Archpray, published by Rayark, and was released on October 25th, 2019. We'll be seeing what it does right, what it does wrong, and answering the quintessential question, is it worth your money? First up, the technical bits. The system requirements for PC are on screen right now, and they aren't very ridiculous. The game is quite accommodating to budget PC builds, so most of you should run it fine. It's also been confirmed for the Nintendo Switch. For me, it ran very smoothly for the most part, which is especially important in games like this because some of the platforming requires precision and timing. I did encounter a few hitches, but only during loading screens, so it didn't actually hurt anything. I also had one crash during gameplay, but seeing as it was an isolated event, I'm not gonna go too hard on the game for it. Overall, I was satisfied with how the game ran. Art and music. The art is done in a kind of pixelated style, reminiscent of Dead Cells. Each stage also has a different aesthetic, though it all gave me an ominous feeling, which is what I think they were going for. The music is mostly done in a light orchestral style. I personally don't have much to say about it. I like it, but to me it didn't blow me out of the water. I'll have music from the soundtrack playing in the background, so you'll be able to judge for yourself. Overall, I'd say the presentation of the game is pretty good. On to story. The story of Astray is interesting. You're this little weird blob thing in a destroyed lab on an alien planet being guided by a disembodied voice. You're given very little to work with at the start and have to kind of piece together what happened as you play. The story is delivered to you in a couple ways, and it's not all just spoon-fed to you. One of the gimmicks is that the blob, named Mo, can latch onto the heads of enemies and corpses to read their mind. When you read the mind of one of these zombie creatures, you get a little snippet of what they were thinking before everything went wrong. There'll also be glowing corpses that'll give you a little cutscene, usually showing the moments leading up to its death. And of course, as you progress through the game, you'll see all the aftermath, and the disembodied voice will occasionally give you a few tidbits to work with. It all comes together, and it's very satisfying to see it all come together. And no spoilers, but there were definitely a few revelations that made me go, "Oh shit, that's what happened." I love seeing stories told through unconventional means, and Astray's story was very interesting. Now, on to gameplay. Astray is very different from any other platformer I've ever played, and it took a little getting used to. And it's worth noting that a controller is strongly recommended for this game. Some of the core features of movement are completely different from other platformers, and the game is built around that. The way it works is that you set your launch trajectory when you jump, but you have no control while in the air. You can also stick onto walls and ceilings, but cannot move except to jump again or drop down. Once again, it took some getting used to, but once I got the hang of it, it was a lot of fun. As you progress through the game, you'll get more abilities, which will open up the possibilities. For example, there's the aforementioned head-grabbing ability, which allows you to mind-control living enemies and to use hanging corpses as additional platforms. There's also a double jump that seriously frees up your movement to an insane degree. And there's a dash that allows you to get through previously impassable obstacles and finally gives you a way to actually attack enemies. And the level design does a great job of incorporating the abilities you have with environmental factors to make each stage feel unique and challenging. The puzzle portions at times made me think a bit about how to actually get through. They weren't ridiculously difficult, but enough to give me that light bulb over the head moment when I figured them out. A lot of times I'd figure out the solution to a puzzle and be like, "Oh hey, that's clever." Especially when it did something cool with the environment or had an interesting failure state. For example, there was one environmental obstacle that was this plant that would explode and fire these needles everywhere. In some stages, these were an obstacle to avoid. In others, you had to find an object or enemy that could make them explode while you hide away. It was all really awesome. But while the game is primarily a puzzle platformer, it has its fair share of precision-based platforming as well. I'm the kind of player who enjoys high-difficulty precision platformers like Celeste and The Messenger, so I was happy that the game wasn't purely cerebral. There were a lot of cases where you have to time your jumps properly and utilize your abilities to their fullest. This is especially true once you unlock the double jump, which is the only thing that gives you any degree of control in the air. It allows you to navigate tricky platforms and jump around obstacles. The controls here are pretty tight, which is incredibly important in any game that has precision platforming. For the most part, Mo moved as I expected him to move, not counting the times where I screwed up, of course. There weren't any instances where I felt that the game screwed me over. Every death was absolutely my own fault, which is something that I believe is a necessity in games like this. The one thing I will criticize is how long jumps tend to arc. Jumps don't really have this perfect parabola. Gravity kind of takes over partway through, and sometimes the jump feels like it ends up shorter than what it actually should be. This wasn't a huge issue, as most obstacles don't actually require a max range standing jump, and it isn't a factor at all once you unlock the double jump. The double jump is shorter than a regular jump, so it actually follows the expected parabola pretty well. Again, this wasn't a huge issue, but it did throw me off a bit early on, and a few obstacles kind of pissed me off because of it. There are also these collectibles called memory fragments. Typically, they're hidden in secret areas, or you have to go through a more difficult obstacle to get to them. These will unlock a little bit more story content in the form of a few sentences, kind of like when you're mind controlling a corpse. And additionally, every 5 you collect will raise your maximum health. I'm also not going to spoil it, but collecting them actually affects the story in a pretty neat way that actually fits thematically. But regardless, there's one reason you'll want to collect them all anyway. You'll need that health for the boss fights. Oh yeah, for me, the boss fights were the absolute highlight of the experience. Yes, the puzzle elements were great, but when I think back on the game I just played, this is what comes to mind. Now, for most of the game, you can't actually attack, since you don't have a dash. And even once you get it, it's not really enough to kill anything on its own. That means that Archpray had to be very clever in how they designed these encounters. Each one has its own gimmick that isn't really all that hard to figure out, but you have to work around it while not getting hit in the process, which is a lot easier said than done. For example, one boss will have these little sections exposed as it lashes out at you. If you cling to them, you can dodge out of the way, causing the boss to stab itself. Or take a look at the Fatal Trap boss. This one's really cool. You're on these 4 spinning platforms, and remember that you can't move while you're stuck to things, you can only jump. As the platforms spin, monsters are trying to shoot you, and one platform at a time will light up. After jumping to the lit platform a couple times, it'll shoot out a laser that can kill the monsters shooting at you. It's a very innovative way to handle a boss fight, and every single boss in Astray has these unique mechanics that make them some of my favorite bosses in any platformer. So in conclusion, what do I think? Astray is certainly one of the more inventive platformers I've played. It's got a nice balance of puzzle and precision elements, though hardcore puzzle enthusiasts might be left a little disappointed by the lack of super difficult puzzles. The game looks and sounds pretty nice, with a style that isn't necessarily my favorite, but fits what they were going for. The controls are tight, the level design is incredible, and the bosses are absolutely amazing. The playtime was on the shorter side. I beat the game on normal difficulty in around 6 hours of playtime, though some obstacles and bosses may take a little longer for people who aren't as experienced as me. So what's the verdict? If you've watched any of my reviews, you'll know that I hate traditional review scores. I don't think they do a damn bit of good, and they don't really mean anything anyway. So instead, I'll ask and answer the question that's really on your mind. Is it worth your money? Astray is available on Steam for $14.99 or your regional equivalent. I'd say at that price, it's worth your money. This is an incredible game, and I can't believe that I'd never even heard of it before. Definitely something you should consider picking up. Astray is currently available on the May 2020 Humble Choice from Humble Bundle. For as low as $15 a month, the same price as buying the game outright, you can take your pick from a pool of 12 games to keep forever. It's a service I personally use and pay for. There'll be a link in the description if you're interested. The video is not sponsored, but if you use my link, I will make a few bucks off of it. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please make sure to leave a like and subscribe if you want to see more. It really does help get my content in front of more eyeballs. I upload every Monday, so make sure to check back in next week. Follow me on Twitter at AdzTweets for updates and memes, and follow me on Twitch at AdzGames, where I'll be streaming regularly once this lockdown stops making me work crazy hours. Once again, thank you all for watching, and I'll see you next Monday. Hit the road, Jack. Don't you come back, no.